Welcome back to the shop, guys. My name's Adam, and we're working on another Saturday Night Special. This is episode 78, and I've got a lot to talk about this week. We've got another action-packed episode here. Got a lot of different things, lots of different content and subject matter here to talk about. And we'll start right off with the big elephant in the room, the K&T. And you see what's missing over here, don't you? All you guys that didn't think I was going to work on this, we finally started the work on the K&T, okay? So we've got some footage of that. I'm going to throw that in there for this episode, and you're going to get to see what I've done with the Kearney and Trekker so far, all right? It is not fixed yet, I will tell you that, but you do have the footage of me removing this, and we got to take it down there to the table and start doing some inspection. So we got that, and as that work progresses, I'll continue to bring that for you to see, okay? I am taking lots of video and lots of pictures for you guys to watch, and also maybe to help others out there on the web. Later on, we might post some of these pictures up on a forum or something like that, okay? So we'll get to that. And so I want to go ahead and just move on and give you guys another reminder that we have our ShopLite t-shirt still for sale. It's going to be ending on July the 16th, Thursday. So as you're watching this, you've got about another 5 or 6 days that you can still reserve one. Again, prices start at $20. They range from $20 to $25, depending on what size shirt you want. And I got a little bit more of an update for you this week. I've had some guys ask me about quality. I actually like these shirts better than the ones I got from Teespring. This is Gildan, and for me, this is my sample shirt, I'm wearing it here. I think it fits a little bit better than the other. I think I like it a little bit more. So, and again, we have the pockets, so we get a pocket tee, and just trying to have a nice successful campaign there, guys. So it's over at tblaster.com. Again, I'll throw the link up there and show some pictures so that you'll see what to go to, and I'll have a link there in the description down below the video. You can just click straight on that, and it'll take you right to where you need to go, okay? So I just want to thank everybody that's given me support. I really appreciate it. These shirts is what helped support this shop. So hope you like it, and go check you out a shirt, okay? All right, so we've got some more view appreciation mail I'm going to show you this week. I've got some new tools, and I've got a flea market tool that I picked up actually a few weeks ago, and never did fit it into the other SNS. So we're going to show that this week because it was a neat little tool that I found, and we actually demonstrated how it worked, and I want to throw that in there. So you're going to get to see a flea market find and actually test it and use it. I got a little clip from last weekend, 4th of July, for the barbecue. I did a little clip there. I have a lot of guys that do enjoy seeing the outdoor barbecuing clips from out there cooking. So I did a little segment for that. We're going to throw that in there. And that's about it. I got a couple things here I'm going to show you. I thought I would go ahead and say that I have given Jody over at Weldon Tips and Tricks. I give him a little support. I ordered his 4th of July special, so we've got the DVD right here and the two tick fingers, the tick finger and the extra large tick finger. And he's still got these on sale. I don't know how much longer he's going to have these on sale, but these were on sale, I think, for the kit was like $55, $57 or something like that. So I've been wanting a tick finger, and I've been meaning to buy one for a while, and it slips my mind to ever do it. And then I seen him promoting this, and I said, I'm going to go ahead and get my TIG finger, and I went ahead and got the 4th of July package deal. So, Jody, I like the TIG finger, man. I can't wait to start using it. This is going to be extremely helpful in my future welding projects there. So, we got that. And then we got a couple of the tools I'll bring in and show you that we got past couple of weeks, and hopefully you'll enjoy the episode, okay? All right, so we got some viewer appreciation mail that was sent in, and this was given to us by Rob Klein, and he is from, let me see, it was Campbell Hall, New York, and got a nice little mix of just different things, and I wanted to point this out. The okay, it's a Rockwell. So he had emailed me and showed me this picture on my email and said that he found this on Craigslist there local to him, and I believe he paid $350 for it. And it's a Rockwell horizontal milling machine. So he picked that up, and he was telling me that he's going to be he's going to have this mill running before I have the K&T running. So you're probably right there, Rob, but or Bob. I mean, I'm sorry. I think I called you Rob. It's Bob. All right. So Bob has sent me a couple things here. We got some welding shields here, and we have some lumber crayon, some red and yellow. Okay, and we have a couple knives, but actually this is pretty cool. I don't have any kind of knives like this out here in the shop, and I have seen where these could be useful cutting boxes and foam and things like that. So we'll keep these out here and have some knives out here in the shop. Okay, might even be able to use those for the barbecue. All right, and got a cool magnet right there. These come in handy. This is from a scrap yard up there. AW Scrap, Wappingers Falls, New York. Wappingers, that's a weird name. But anyway, got a magnet right there. That nice strong magnet too, man. And then this one is a Cipriano Towing. Got a little flashlight right there, keychain. Pretty cool stuff, okay. And then we got this really nice big hand reamer. And this is kind of an oddity, 1 13/32. But it appears to be new. It's still very sharp, in good shape right there. All right, and then the last thing is a nice sterret box right there. But nothing in it, but he thought that I would like that, and maybe use that to pull a practical joke on somebody. But honestly, maybe somebody's got some the calipers that belong in here. What is that, the sterret number 120, I think it is, that they go in. So got a nice case there that somebody can probably put to use. And so that's it. Thank you very much, Rob. Very nice tool, and we will put that with the collections, and hopefully one day we'll get to put it to use, okay? We had another very nice package from our friend Avi over at Noga Industries, and he has sent me a few different tools right here to try out here in the shop. We got some more deburr tools, and we have one of their new hold it arms, and he sent a fresh catalog that shows all of their new hold it products. This is specifically designed for camera, video, and lighting, and that kind of stuff. That's pretty cool, so we'll check that out. And we've also got a Cool It, I believe that's what it was, Mini Cool. I'm sorry, we got the Mini Cool. So I've actually been wanting to try this thing out over on the mill, and Stan over at Shaden HKW, he recently got one of these, and he hooked it up to his surface grinder, and he showed how he likes it and how it works. And so far it's getting really good reviews. I believe this is the same unit that Tom Lipton uses on his milling machine. So I've been seeing everybody use this system, or several of the guys use it, and this is really nice right here. So we're gonna try this out over on my mill and give it a shot. So that's very cool right there. We also got a couple of the gifts from Avi, and one is this really cool watch, okay? And it's got Noga on the face of the watch there. So this is made by Adi Watches. Let's see, I think that opens up like that. Yeah. And it's an Israeli company also, made in Israel. And very fine watch, seems to be a very nice quality. And that's awesome, Avi, thank you very much for that. And one of these 8 gig thumb drives that looks like one of their D-Burr handles. These actually come in handy whenever I'm on the road and I do video outside of the shop here. I can throw a video onto these right here. So thank you very much, Avi, for those. All right, so we got our mini cool system right here, and this is the hold it arm, okay? And so I can mount this to one of the mag bases right here. And then this, I believe this is gonna be a standard quarter 20 thread, which is kind of like industry standard for cameras, like tripod mounts and cameras and all kind of things like that. So what this is right here, this is like a jam nut. So you screw this onto your camera and then you can jam it with this. It's got a really nice rubbery piece in there. It's molded, it's got the end for the Noga on it. And their tightening arm is, it's not a thumb wheel like on your indicator holders. This one is just more of your straight handle style, but you can adjust it where you want it. But it has the same feel, quality, and build as the standard Noga arms for the indicator holders. All right, so that's pretty cool. We'll have to try to incorporate this in our video making, okay? So, and then we've got several different scraping tools and deburr tools right here. I'll quickly pull these out and show you which ones we got. They're for different things. I told them that I didn't have any of the ones specific for plastics, and I had been looking at those and was wanting to try some for the plastic. Now this one right here is going to be the DB5000. Okay, that's got a ceramic V blade in there, and this one, ceramic double burr right here. All right, it looks like they're cutting the corner of a piece of UHMW. All right, I've got some UHMW down here, so we've got some pieces like that we want to deburr. Do the corners just like so. Nice, that works good. That works very good, cool. Okay, so again, that one is the DB5000. All right, we've got another one here that's similar to that, but this one is for steel. This is the DB1000. Now, this one actually has the two rollers on the end, and this one is for sheet metal in that configuration, or you can take them off and install one in the center hole there, and then it positions it so that you can put it on the center, or I'm sorry, the corner of a block like this, when you move that, and you can drag it and you can deburr that just the corner there. And the configure that it's in right now, you can take a piece of sheet metal, that this is some aluminum right here, but you can take this and, okay, you drag it down a piece of sheet metal and you can deburr it right there. All right, we got this guy. I think this was boxed separately. Got a nice little scraper right there, man. All right, got one of the scrapers. This is adjustable. Position it where you want it. Okay. All right, we've got a CR2300. All right, now this is going to be one of the ceramic tools. Go ahead and pull that out here. This is another one of the ceramic deburr tools. It's for plastics, soft plastics, and putting my glasses on, because if I don't, I know some of you guys are gonna murder me for it. So I just grabbed this piece from over there by the wall. So, all right, so you can take that and deburr holes. So that works pretty good. I'll have to keep playing with that, but all right. Okay. And we've got an NC5200. All right, now this is also one of your ceramics, and it rolls around like that. NC5200, and this one is ideal for deburring hard abrasive plastics. Okay. All right, and we got one more. We got one more here. All right, now this one is the RC2000. And how this one works right here, you have a little triangle blade at the end. And this is made for deburring the inside of small holes. So you stick it through the hole. If you want to get to the back side, you know, you don't have no way to really deburr that, but you can use this tool here. So you can turn your blade that way, stick it up in the hole, and then you can push the little plunger on the end. All right, it's got a little rod there that pushes the blade, and then you kind of pull on it, and then you're pulling against the hole, and then you turn it, and then you can deburr the back side of the hole right there. Okay, then you can push it in to straighten the blade back out, and then pull it out of the hole. So that's pretty neat right there. It's got a little, there's a little needle type plunger deal that's put, that's going up and pushing that. So that's a pretty neat little, I could have used this a lot of times whenever you want to deburr. If you got a part that you got to drill a hole down the center, and you know it's way up inside there, you really don't have a way to get in there and clean that hole up really well. But sometimes you can take a tool like this, if you got one, and go in there and do a deburr, okay? Especially on a flat surface right there. All right, so there's our deburrs. We've also got this kit here, and I didn't see that in the catalog. This is an FT3000. And I believe this is a very miniature deburr kit right there. You can see how small that blade profile is. Okay, very, very small. And then this other one here kind of tails the tail also. It's one of those for deburring a hole, chamfering a hole, and it's very small, very tiny. So this kit right here is intended for some small holes. All right, and then we got the little scraper there also. Awesome tools, man. Nice tools for the collection here, and they will be put to use. I'm really excited about these ceramic tools and deburring these plastic parts. So that'll come in handy right there, man. Remember, we got some plastic that we're machining. We've got the one that we can scrape the edges with, and then we got some holes that we drill. We got a couple different flavors of ceramics to go in there and deburr the plastic. So, all right, and then of course he threw in some fresh catalogs right here of all the stuff. So, got the cool watch there and the thumb drive. Thank you very much, Avi. Really, really appreciate this stuff. It'll be well used around here. I'm looking forward to the jobs that we can actually show these products in action and see just how well they work, okay? So again, thank you very much, all you guys over there at Noga Industries. Man, you guys are awesome. So this is a recent tool acquisition for me. It's something that I was actually pretty excited to get. I've kind of talked about this in the past in other videos, and I always have wanted one of these little 4-inch sterret levels, so I finally got me one. I found this online. It was on one of the machinist tool buy, sell, and trade on Facebook. There was a guy that had a whole list of things, and I seen this. He had this level on there, and he was looking for offers, and so I sent him an offer, and we made a deal, and I'm now the owner of this little vintage stair at 4-inch level, and it is in very clean condition. It is the older type that's got just the radius machined into the bottom. The newer style actually has like an involute style groove, and I believe the newer ones are satin chrome finish versus this old chrome finish right here. But it's been well taken care of. It does have a name on the side. It's hard for me to pronounce that last name. I'm gonna attempt it though. It's Bob Cresselius. So anybody know Bob Cresselius? It would come from up north. I don't recall the state now. So that was his level, and he had a lot of really nice clean machinist tools. So this is the box that it came with right here. Very nice little box. They got a little oily rag down in the bottom there to help keep it from rusting. So I'm assuming this is a homemade, or you know, like a shop made box that was specifically made for this level. I don't know if this was stair. I don't think it is. It looks more homemade. So that's my little machinist tool purchase of the week right there. We got our number 98 4-inch stair at level. What's up, guys? We're gonna do a flea market segment here. I just got back from the flea market and I found a couple antique tools out there today, and I was able to get them for a really good price, so I grabbed them up for a couple different reasons. One is that I've never seen them before, never got to use them, and they both look like they're in great shape. And two, I think that these may, especially this one here, might make a good contribution to possibly David Richards' steam powered shop. I think this is going to be kind of an authentic tool for his time period of the machine shop there. So if not, I'll hold on to it around here. But a couple little things I grab is a nice file card and a pretty nice die stock handle right here. So we got this is all from the same gentleman. So this one I'm not going to really delve into too much, but I'm going to share it with you. It is an old antique tool. And what I find really interesting about it, I can tell by the tag right here. It's got a nice bright brass tag, and I'll take a picture so you can see it. But it says the Toledo number 1 and manufactured by the Toledo Pipe Threading Machine Company. And number A2316. So it's a pipe threader, and I think the way that this works, you see this part turns, you have a bushing that goes into here. Once you remove these thumb screws, you pull those all the way, you back those all the way out, and this bushing comes out. And you see I've got a couple more sets here, bushing and dies. So I believe this is a bushing, and what you do is you back this all the way out, you unscrew it. Right about there, it's got these four alignment pins. Keep everything square. Slide it up on the pipe. Tighten the three thumb screws. And then your pipe will be right up there against your dies. And then you start threading it. And this is going to go on. You keep screwing it. And it'll come to a stopping point. So I don't know if you do the whole range, but I'm assuming that you run it all the way up to the full range and then it'll stop. And then that's probably going to be your proper cut on the end of the pipe. So that was pretty neat. It looks like a very old tool. It is missing the two handles, but those could be easily made. They're usually just pipe. Okay, so there's that one there. But I found this one, and this one I thought was really neat right here, man. As soon as I picked it up, I could tell we had something that was built of really nice quality. So what this is a pipe cutter, okay? And this was manufactured by, and it says, the number 5 improved beaver square and pipe cutter, steel frame. Manufactured by the Borden Company, Warren, Ohio, USA. And it's got the beaver trademark. U.S. Patent October 1st, 1912, and also October 22nd, 1918. So I thought that was awesome and a good score. So what I figured out that this is a pipe cutter, okay? I know most of you guys are familiar with a standard, like a rigid type of little pipe cutter. It's got the little blade, and you screw it on there, and you tighten it up and run it around the pipe, and it cuts it off. This is essentially the same thing, except what it uses is these two blades here, and they're made just like a parting blade on, you know, for a lathe. And I've already played with it for just a little bit. I Scotch-Brite this so I could read this good, and I made one test cut on it, and it seems to be the way that it's made is it's either right or left hand. You can spin it either direction, and either direction you spin it is gonna cut, okay? So I don't know which way is the correct way. I was trying right-handed, and I tried left-handed, and they cut both directions. So on the back, you can see you've got the V-jaws in here. So these are spring-loaded. Once you put it up on your pipe, you tighten it up, and it pushes these blades back, and that's what creates your tool pressure. And you just tighten it on up to the V's there, put some oil on it, and you start spinning it. So what I thought we could do is let's go give it a test. All right, I got a piece of pipe over there. I think it's some 3/4 pipe. And I'm even gonna break out my little rigid yoke vise, and we're gonna cut us a piece of pipe off of this thing, okay? So this is the vise that I'm gonna use. This is a rigid yoke vise. Man, I've had this thing for years and years, and I've actually only used it just a handful of times. I bought this thing when I was a teenager at a yard sale. I was going to show you how it was made. I've never cleaned it up. It's really nice. You can clamp it to a table using the built-in C-clamp there, or you could bolt it down if you want to. So I'm just going to slide it up on the edge of the table. Give it a pull. And there's the pipe we're going to use right here. Okay, all right, make sure you can see it good. So like I said, you slide it on. You gotta open it up. You're going there so far, and then you screw it closed, and those blades, grab it so you can see it. Got you at the wrong angle. Just closing them up. I'm going to close it up until it fits around the pipe good. So they're pulled up on the pipe there. I'll go ahead and put a little bit of cutting oil here. This one here, pulling the chip over. So you don't have to keep tightening it like the normal style that you usually use. That spring tension is keeping the blades tight. So, like I said, I believe it's right or left hand, because see, you can go this way. Let's see. And then this side's gonna cut, see? There it is. So that's how you're gonna do it in the field, or that's how they did it in the old days when you didn't have your power tools around. So you use that to cut it off, and you come back in with your pipe threader and thread it. So I think that's a pretty neat tool right there. So I just wanted to give a mention to David Richards and his steam-powered machine shop, and he likes to keep all his tools authentic. So David, if you think this is something that's authentic for your shop and you would like to have this and use it, let me know and I'll be glad to send it to you and donate it to the cause. Okay, man? Hey guys, welcome back to the shop. My name's Adam, and we're now working on Saturday Night Special Episode 80. So we've got a lot of good stuff to talk about this week. First thing I want to mention is, guys, we hit 40,000 subscribers to the channel this week. And I cannot be more impressed and more excited than I've ever been about this YouTube channel. Thank you very much, man. Thank you so much for all of the support that I continue to get for my work here in this channel and my humble little shop and all of the things that I keep bringing you and we show you on video. Just thank you very much. I guess I'm doing something right. I never imagined that I was going to have 40,000 subscribers. I remember when I first started posting videos two summers ago, I think May 2013, I started posting some videos up, and at that time I never even really used YouTube very much. I remember doing some searches on YouTube for machine shops, and the first person that I ever found on YouTube that did machine work was none other than Keith Fenner. And to be specific, the first video that I ever seen of Keith Fenner's was his Super Shaker video. And I remember watching that video and first time meeting Keith. And then I looked and seen that he had at that time he had about 25,000 subscribers. And I was thinking to myself, man, that is amazing to have that many subscribers, that many people interested watching you doing what you do. And it wasn't long after that I started doing videos. And instantly, I started getting subscribers every day. It just kept building and building. And I just didn't, you know, I still don't know what to say. I always try to bring the words that I don't know how to say it. I guess some other people are better at talking than I am. I'm better at showing you what I'm doing. But anyway, we hit 40,000 subscribers. And I was trying to watch my phone there and see when 40,000 hit. It hit overnight, and I woke up the next morning and I checked it, and it was like 40,000 something. I took a picture there, a screenshot I'll throw up there and show you. And now we're well above that. But anyway, to all the new guys that's been subscribing and just now tuning in, thank you very much. Go back and check out some of the older footage, and you'll see a lot of things. I get a lot of comments about the videos and suggestions about things to talk about, you know, subject matter. Don't be afraid to go back, look past in my videos, and you might find some stuff that you didn't know was there. I've had guys ask me about drill grinding. I did a video on drill grinding. I used to do a series there called Shop Talk, and I've thought about bringing that series back, doing Shop Talk. So we may do some more of those in the future. But to all the guys that been with me since the beginning, thank you. Whenever you leave a comment, I see the comments, and I see names that have been posting comments since I first started putting videos out. And you can even go in analytics and you can see who was subscribing to you, your first subscribers, and you can do them in order. And it's really interesting to go through that list and see everybody that subscribed to you. So, again, thank you very much, everybody. And I want to hopefully just keep this going. And this is YouTube is a great thing. You know, it's really awesome. And I really enjoy doing what I'm doing here and bringing all this stuff to video. And I enjoy watching everybody else's videos too. So, all right, so we're gonna kind of move on from that subject. I just wanted to give everybody a thanks that we hit the 40,000. So next thing I want to say is that we've got a lot of content this week, okay? And on top of that, I want to mention that I've been extremely busy. Not necessarily here with this shop, but we've been busy at work. And we've had to do a lot of overtime. This past weekend, we worked the entire weekend, Saturday, Sunday. So all I've had off is kind of like evenings, and sometimes we're coming home really late. So the benefit there is not only am I making overtime, which is always awesome, I did get a little bit of video, some pictures and stuff of some of these different jobs and things going on that I plan on bringing to you to the Saturday night. And we're going to throw some of that in this episode. And I believe this is going to be a two-parter because I've got a lot of stuff to share with you. So we might have a part one and part two. I don't know yet, but I imagine there is going to be. So I've been really busy. I haven't had a lot of time to do stuff here in my shop. I came out here this week and got one thing done, and that's going to be in this week's episode. You'll get to see that. And I have other things going on in life, personal matters that I'm having to tend to also. And you'll probably hear about that in one of these episodes. I've got something to share with you. And we'll leave it at that. Okay. So I've also got some viewer appreciation mail. We're going to show those real quick. We got a new tool to talk about. I'm going to give you some K&T updates, Kearney and Trekker. I haven't had a lot of time to work on this, but we have made a little bit of progress, and that's some of the footage you're going to see in this video is about some of the parts that we're looking at on the K&T. Okay. As I already mentioned, we've got I'm going to bring you a Hayman project, and that's actually last weekend's overtime job, okay? It's probably going to be a slideshow. I didn't get a lot of video, but you guys will probably enjoy what you see in there. It was a big job, and it took a lot of hours and a lot of guys on it to get this thing done, and we got it done. So I'm going to share those pictures with you, okay? And I got some more footage from work, random machining videos from work, some threading. I had a large hydraulic tube that I was building, and I got a little bit of the threading action there. I know you guys enjoy seeing that. I have a lot of people that comment on that. So I always try to get a different angle and put the camera in a couple different spots so that you can see what I'm doing, throwing the half nut lever and disengaging and stuff like that. So we're going to try to throw those in there this week. And I think that's all the updates I got for you. So I guess that's going to be about it. Hopefully you're going to be getting your Shop Life t-shirts any day now. They told me that it'd be 1 to 2 weeks is when people is going to be getting their shirts in the mail. So I'm looking forward to hearing from you guys that ordered, and let me know what you think of the shirts. Throw a picture up there and let me see, man. I'd love to see it, okay? So one more thing I want to mention real quick is that to Brad and all the guys in the What's in Your Toolbox Toolmakers collaboration, hopefully pretty soon I'm gonna get started on my part of the Machinist Vice. I got the prints down here, and that's gonna be something that's gonna be coming in the next few weeks. All right, as soon as I have time, we're gonna start that project, and that will be its own series of videos so that it's easier for people to find that and watch it, okay? So Brad, I have not forgot about you, and you're doing an awesome job by collaborating with everybody and pulling this little group together to build these tools. And I'm looking forward to being a part of that and make this vice body, and that's gonna be pretty neat. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll get to our viewer appreciation mail, and we'll move on to some machining. Okay, this is our reverse viewer appreciation mail. And this is some chili powder that was sent to me by our friend James Green out in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And on YouTube, he's known as Eagle Dust Off. this is one of the stickers that he had sent me. James Green is a retired war veteran, and he was from the 101st Airborne Division, Air Assault, 50th Medical Company. So James has a series on YouTube called Short Series Shenanigans. I know a lot of you watching probably know that, but those that don't, check out James Green. He's a really nice guy, and he does a lot of gunsmithing work, and he recently got a new lathe, and he's been doing a lot of videos on that. But he's out in Albuquerque, and funny thing about Albuquerque and all that area out west is that even though I've never even been there, I just love that area. I really love the area, and something about out west, I just like it. I could see myself actually living there, but I live in Florida. So he sent me some hot green chili powder, okay? We got the hot green chili powder here, and then we have the medium hot roasted chili powders right here. So he sent that to me, said to try it out on some of the barbecue. You know, I do the barbecue a lot when I have time. So we're gonna be trying some of this out, James. I really appreciate it, and thank you very much, all right? Okay, so we got our second box of viewer appreciation mail, and this is from James Kilroy, and he is in Vicksburg, Mississippi. He's another great guy to check out on YouTube, so check his channel out there. I'll throw the link up there for you. And what he's done is he sent me, James, in case you didn't know, is the person that I bought the KMT mill from, okay? This used to be his mill. I went to Mississippi to buy it from him, and James is a cool dude. And he's got a nice stockpile of tooling up there in his shop. He had a box that had some of the extra parts off the K&T here that he couldn't find when I was there. So he finally found the parts. There's some more of the handles for the locks. And we got a couple oil lines and some bolts and a couple of accessories in there. So he wanted to send those to me. And then he also threw in some extras. This is a GoPro case that he makes on his 3D printer. And he made one for me. Got the A-Bomb 79 on it. So we're gonna try that out with one of the GoPro cameras. Okay, I actually got the GoPros right here. I've been downloading some video and I've just got them there. So thank you very much for that, James. And he's also sent me some of the now famous 5/16 24 spiral pointed taps. Another pack of them here. And I think he must have about 20,000 of these taps right here. He's got more than a lifetime supply. And we got some milling cutters that he sent here also. These are some of the kind of odd size. It's a 7/32 width, 5-inch diameter, 1¼-inch arbor. So this is another, I think he's got a bunch of these also, and he's been donating some of these to a few of the other guys also. So thank you, James. And then we have one more, and I don't know about this, maybe he's got a few of these too, but this is a brand new, I believe that's United Tool and Die, 1-inch taper sink drill bit with a number 3 Morse taper, okay? So, some nice tools from Mr. James, I'm sorry, James Kilroy. And appreciate it. Appreciate the tools, James. Thank you very much for the case. He said that he sent me one of these already in the past and I never got it, so I think he sent a package that got lost in the mail. So he printed me out another one of these, and got to thank you very much, James. And we got the K&T parts right here. So, all right, thanks. All right, so what we got here is the relief valve for the Kearney and Trekker. And what I want to do is test it. I want to put a pressure test on it and be able to see it, bench test it to see if this thing is performing like it should. The recommended pressure from Kearney and Trekker is 200 to 225 PSI. And this is actually where you adjust it with this side right here. This side is your lube side. This is for your knee lube. And you can adjust it also. I believe it's supposed to be somewhere between 25 and 30 PSI. So what I want to do is check it. And this is the gauge that I actually had on the knee. And we're using that. That's a perfect gauge there. It only goes up to 600. So I'm having a difficult time trying to put something together to test it with, and what I want to use is a little Porta Power. So I have found a this is 3/8 pipe, by the way. This is the fitting that goes in the end right here, and then your oil line coming from your pump goes into here. All right, so this is 3/8 pipe thread, 3/8 NPT. It's tapered pipe. I do have a nipple here. This is 3/8, so what I'd like to do is build something like this. So if you're kind of looking at it that way, have something that this is screwed into. All right, we can screw, this is the adapter that you need for the Porta Power hydraulic cylinder. So that'll screw into a piece right there. And then what I'll do is just drill and tap it, probably just 1/8 like I got right here, and then have the gauge screwed on top of it in between the two fittings. And then of course your line for your Porta Power will hook into this one, this side right here. And then you should be able to pump the cylinder and energize this and hopefully get a good pressure reading on this right here. So that's my plan anyway. I will have to, we'll probably just cut a couple little pieces of steel, some cold roll, and use a clamp to, and just C-clamp it on this line right here to keep the oil from coming out. And I think that's it. So I need to build something though. That's what I was getting at. I don't have any other pipe fittings around here to adapt all this stuff together. So I'm just going to take a piece of steel, maybe a piece of round stock, and just drill and tap each end for 3/8 pipe, and then set it up in the mill and drill and tap through the top of it right in the center for a 1/8 pipe. Okay, so that's what we're going to do there. All right, and I'll show you once it's all finished up. All right, that's a piece of 1 3/16 stress proof. It's easy to cut, that's why I grabbed it. So we're just gonna drill and tap each side. We'll have a hole going all the way through it. And we'll probably set up in the mill and mill us a couple wrench flats on it so we can hold it to tighten it up. I'm just gonna go ahead and face this this extra off of it. Okay. Oop. I guess I didn't have it very tight. I'm just gonna drill a 5/16 hole all the way through it, okay? And then we'll drill each side tap size. I believe that's 19/32. I gotta go look. All right, here's our tap drill size. Go about 1 inch deep on each side of it here. All right, let's see how she'll do power tapping. Three-eighths tap, pipe tap is just a little bit bigger than the range of straight tap wrench that'll swing on this lathe right here. I had to go to the next biggest size, which like this guy right here, and it won't swing. All right, let's try that. One of the neat features of this Victor, it's got a reverse jog button down here. That's all I'm doing, I'm just hitting that button. All right, that's one side tapped, and both of them fit there. Okay, and we'll use some we won't use Teflon tape on this. We're going to be using actual thread sealant by Loctite. All right, so we just need to flip it around now. We're good to go there. Okay, so just gonna flip it around and repeat on this side. We'll do a face, drill, and tap. All right. All right, we're just gonna put a couple flats on the side here. Got an old half inch end mill that we're gonna use, and mill a couple flats and then just drill and tap it for that center pipe hole there, okay? So what I'm doing is, there's no specific length that I want. I just want to fit a wrench on there, and that's going to be plenty adequate. So I've got a zero set right here. I'm going to make it 1 inch. That's 1 3/16. So 3/16 divided by two, that's going to be 93.5 per side, 3/32. All right, so, and that doesn't have to be dead nuts. You know, I'm just touching off, okay? I'm gonna go 93. That's about 93.5. I'm gonna go ahead and set a zero. All right, we got her locked. I'm gonna feed her in. That end mill, I think, is pretty dull. All right, that's our zero right there. That looks like that's gonna give us plenty. I'm gonna go back off with it. Turn the cutter off. Yeah, plenty of flat there. Okay, so what we'll do is just move it over 1.5 inches. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 2, 4, and then 5. And that will actually be our where we want to be. We'll look at that. But I don't like climb milling, so what we're gonna do, I'm gonna eliminate the backlash here. Set a zero, okay. I'm gonna go one revolution. We're gonna come in, eyeball, zero. I'm going to pull the table back towards me to this zero. All right, we'll feed out. Let me see. Let me go grab a 1 inch wrench real quick. Okay, I had her down there on the welder table. Okay, there we go, see? Nice fit. By the way, we're using our SK Wayne from Stan had given me. Stan, I actually like these wrenches, man. They got a nice, I like how they're rounded off. They're easy on the hands. All right, so I've got it zeroed. We're gonna go ahead and find the center now. And so we already know we're on this flat right here. Using a half inch cutter, so we're 1 inch, that's gonna be 1/2 inch plus a 1/4 inch, that's 7.50. 2, 4, 6, 7, and 50. All right, that'll be the center there. So well, I need to get a drill chuck in there and we'll just do a quick drill and tap. I just used my hook scale. We're 2.5 inches long, so just line it up there with the point of the center drill, and we're just gonna spot it. Go in with our number S. Let me double check that. That's 1/8 pipe. No, letter R, I'm sorry. It didn't sound right. I was looking up at my chart. I got tapered pipe and straight pipe. So letter R drill. I screwed my handle back in. It was about to walk out of there. Okay. Not quite. All right, let's get her set up. Tell you what, let's try this new, I hadn't used it yet. Got this, what is that, Micro, it was Fisher, right? Yeah, it's a Fisher brand spring-loaded center. I bought it at the flea market. I think I paid 12 bucks for it. All right, we got our tap wrench. Oh, I got to find a tap. Tell how organized I am today. All right, we got our tap. There's our spring center. I hear a lot of people just call these tap guides. They're also a tap guide. I like to call them a spring-loaded center. Tap feels dull, man. Okay. All right, there we go, right there. If I need to, I can't check it here. It's too tall. I don't feel like taking it out because I've got all this sealed up, so. I'll check it if I need to. I'll run the tap in there a little bit deeper, but I didn't really like the feel of that tap. So may find another one, okay? All right, we finally got our adapter ready so that we can do a bench test on this. Just showing you how it's all gonna go together there. So we've got our adapter we made, and I'm just gonna use a nipple on one side right there. So we'll tighten that up with some thread sealant. And then this side is gonna be the adapter for the Porta Power cylinder. That'll go into there and get tightened up. And then this will all screw into here, into your relief valve. Okay. And then we'll have our gauge right here in the middle so we can read our pressure. And I don't want to twist on that too hard, but you get the idea right there. Okay. So, all right, I don't have the proper Porta Power here, so I'm gonna take this to work tomorrow, and I'll hook it up, and we'll give it a little bench test and see what we see, okay? I'm not really sure what to expect, but we'll see if we're building some pressure anyway, okay? So we're back over on the shaper, just playing around some more, and I had a few guys mention how they would like to see a heavier cut, and I agree. I've been looking forward to getting to some heavy cuts. As I've mentioned before, I've got to continue to play with the tool geometries, different grinds, and see what is going to work best for me since I don't have a lot of experience with a shaper. So that's what I've been doing. So what we got here is I just started a quarter inch cut. Now, this is just a random block of steel. It's probably 1018 cold rolled. Had it out my metal rack outside, and got saw cut. You know, it's not real square, but all right. So this very first cut I made was 200 thousandths deep, and most of these chips here is from that first cut. And I wanted to mention this. So this is the tool that I had used on this first cut. And it's just one of the old chip breaker tools that's been around for a long time. We've used it. And I mean, it's a tool that I've recognized in this shop for years. I just gave it a little additional back clearance because of the type of tool holder that I'm using. So I decided, well, I'm gonna actually grind the tool So all I did was give it side rake, and we got relief on the bottom. And I've noticed that with this type of cutter, that it actually flings the chips off of it. It doesn't drop them like this first one did. It was pretty neat. It would just curl. It would just make a little curl and just fall right there. So I kind of like the way the chip breaker worked right there. So let me fire this thing up, and we'll watch a quarter inch cut. I'm not feeding real aggressive. I think we're running a 4 or 5 thousandths feed rate. We already got her going. All I gotta do is pull the clutch and it's ready to roll. Jumping pretty hard. I mean, that's a pretty aggressive cut for this size machine, but it is handling it. We got it. I'm feeding 5 thousandths per stroke. And so you notice how it flings the chips off. What you got to remember is, if you wanted to utilize this machine for some part making like this, you got a block of steel there that you got to remove a bunch of metal. This works good for that because of that single tool bit. You can do a bunch of hogging and get all that metal out of the way while you're off working somewhere else in the shop if you choose to. It is a slow process, but I'm not making any money off this. I'm just learning and I'm playing and I'm having a good time. Trying to get you a little bit closer.